Bizzibox's expert information on organic farming. What is organic farming?
Organic farming is sustainable farming. It's working with the grain of nature. It's minimising the use of non-renewable external inputs. And it's aimed to promote healthy, vital food. So that means on this farm, we don't use chemical fertilisers, we don't use pesticides, we minimise the use of veterinary drugs like antibiotics and that sort of thing. We only use them in an emergency. And our aim always is to promote the health of the soil, to feed the animals from the farm, and thereby to produce milk, which is a reflection of the farming system. And hopefully that's reflected in the products that we produce here as well.
What are the main benefits of organic farming?
It minimises the use of external inputs. That's very important in a world where we've got climate change and resource depletion. You know, the fossil fuels are starting to run out. That's a big issue. It's based on the principle of self-sufficiency. But more important, in a way, from the point of view of the products, we are farming to enhance the biology of the soil. And if we get that right, then the plants are healthy and the animals are healthy. And it's interesting, we're standing in this field of cows. When you turn a field of cows into a field of really good clover and grass, you can see a bloom on their coats within 12 hours. And that just shows that there is a direct connection between nutrition and health. But most of us, you know, we don't see that connection so directly because there are so many other influences on our health. But the truth is that if we eat good, healthy food, it's directly connected with our health too.
What effects do fertilisers have on the land?
The key fertiliser we don't use here is nitrogen. Nitrogen fertiliser is manufactured using natural gas, which is running out. And when it's applied to the land, there's a big release of nitrous oxide, which is a very potent greenhouse gas. So for fossil fuel depletion reasons and climate change reasons, it's better not to use it. But it goes further than that, because when you use the nitrogen, it suppresses the biological activity of the soil and actually also the clover, which is the main way that we fix nitrogen on this farm. So it's very obviously not the right thing to do. And then of course, the other main fertiliser that farmers use is phosphate, and phosphate is running out. In perhaps 20 or 30 years, the world's reserves of minerals phosphate are going to be so short that people will have to go back to observing the law of return. And that's simply what organic farming is about.
How do you control pest diseases and parasites?
Well, the key way of controlling pest diseases and parasites is through the good farming practice. So that's based on the rotation of crops. We have typically here a 6 or 7 year rotation where we'll have 4 or 5 years of grass, and then we'll grow a crop of oats and a crop of carrots, or maybe the other way around. So 2 years of arable cropping, and then 4 or 5 years of fertility building. Now we're in a wet part of West Wales, whereas back in the east of England, you might have a different rotation where half of it would be the production of crops, which will always change. So one of the key principles behind promoting crop health is diversity. In nature, you will always see diversity. The forest is nature's great teacher, and that's the ultimate ecosystem, enormously diverse. So in a farming system, you mimic nature by not growing two crops in successive years. That way, the pests and disease problems, you'll move away from them because you won't have a build-up. It's exactly the same with weeds. So good husbandry is the key to positive health and, of course, soil management.
Who regulates organic farming?
The Soil Association was one of the first organisations in the world to set organic standards. That was back at the end of the 60s and the beginning of the 70s. And now we have an international regulatory framework. So the European Union has set a baseline for organic standards, and the United States Department of Agriculture has done the same. But we believe that the protection of the integrity of organic standards are best looked after by organisations that are institutionally committed to the principles of sustainability. So the Soil Association has a standard setting board with lots of technical committees, and we look at animal welfare and biodiversity and the use of fertilisers and other inputs, and we make sure that our standards reflect the public interest in sustainability in the environment, and we continue to do that.
What is the Soil Association?
The Soil Association was established by a very far-sighted lady, Lady Eve Balfour, in 1946, and she had a big idea, which was that the health of soil, plants, animals and people and the environment are interconnected. And her idea was that if you got the soil management right, then the result would be healthy plants, animals and people. And she realised, this was just after the war, of course, at the beginning of the chapter of intensive agriculture, that there was a huge degree of public ignorance about the importance of this connection. So she thought, why not set up an organisation to promote the importance of these links? That was the formation of the Soil Association. It preceded the development of the organic market by some 30 years. But in a way, the philosophy and principles behind the Soil Association are really what it's all about.
What makes meat organic?
So for livestock products, the benefits will include highest levels of animal welfare, restrictions on the use of veterinary products, especially things like antibiotics, clear criteria for food, feeding the livestock, no GM, that's important, and a system of husbandry designed to promote animal health.
What makes dairy organic?
The Soil Association's organic dairy standards require the nutrition of the cows to be based on a forage diet. That's important because cows are at their healthiest when they eat clover and grass. Antibiotics are restricted to an absolute minimum, only when the animals are really sick, no routine use. The diet itself will not allow GM or any other non-organic products. And the welfare of the animals at all times is carefully monitored. So you can be sure when you go out buy organic dairy products that you're getting milk from cows that are farmed to the highest welfare standards and managed for their own benefit and positive health.
What makes fruit and vegetables organic?
For organic fruit and vegetables, the key benefits are no chemical fertilisers, no pesticides, and because the crops are grown in harmony with nature using good soil management, a likelihood of better taste and a wider range of trace elements and minerals.
What effect does organic farming have on wildlife?
One of the benefits of organic farming is it's much better for wildlife, because if you farm in harmony with nature, then the wildflowers and the insects and all the creatures which coexist with a sustainable food system of food production are there as part of the farming system. So for instance, on this farm, farmed organically for over 30 years, we have a tremendous population of birds, a greater diversity of species, but more of them as well. Just one example, we've got a lot of sparrows in the farmyard, and the sparrows are eating the remains of the muesli, just the bits and pieces that drop out of the machine or perhaps when they're fed to the cows. And the result is that we have maybe more than 100 house sparrows, which is a very high colony indeed, high colony size, particularly at a time when the RSPB are saying sparrows are a threatened species now in rapid decline.
www.bizzibox.com